constant elevation. 3, 2, 1. What is up, everybody? You are listening, you are watching to the Constant Elevation Podcast. I'm still your host, Gabe Brock. Been out here for a minute. Took a break last week, obviously, because I was at Colorado Springs. There's a lot of stuff going on, and want to start this episode up front. This is going to be the second to the last episode of season 6 of Constant Elevation. So next week, episode 125, will be the last episode of season 6, because I just think it's about that time. I was talking to the homie, Shooter, Sims, and he was asking me some advice as far as how do I know when I want to take a break, and how do I break up my seasons? Do I have any rhyme or reason, any number, anything like that? And I replied, no, actually, I understand when I need to take a break, and I call it there, and so I control my own show, and so I can I know that the energy is out there telling me that, hey, so this is going to be kind of the culmination of season 6. So it's been a good run, a lot of episodes here, and also you get a chance to kind of binge the previous seasons out there as well. So if you haven't already, please subscribe to my podcast, Constant Elevation, wherever you listen to your podcast, as well as this YouTube channel if you choose to listen to the podcast in that format. So before I get into last week as far as why I was gone, a lot of other stuff going on right now. We have now at CrossFit Hampton Roads, we have finished the open. So 2023, at least for me anyway, personally, is behind me. And so 22.3 and 22.2 A and B are all completed. I'll say that I wasn't 100% healthy across both of those workouts, but it doesn't really matter. I get it done. I am a one take Jake kind of athlete. And so I did the workouts with the Hampton Roads athletes, and then also was fortunate enough to kind of be like the ringmaster, flow master for all the Friday Night Lights events. And so at Hampton Roads, we do a little bit different kind of Friday Night Lights events, a lot more social kind of things. We had all the heats going on, and I was out there doing my best to kind of corral the athletes and make sure that the evening goes off well. And so I think the staff, we had a really good divide and conquer kind of strategy. We had Lindsay and Ray doing some of the heat assignments. We had Michelle, auxiliary coach, judge, and then we have Amaraya doing a lot of the multimedia kind of stuff. And I was just the man on the mic doing my thing. And so I find that's actually part of my strengths. And so I didn't mind doing that for the whole, it was only 3 weeks. And so fortunately my health was enough to where I can perform that duty. So if I do that for the 2024 open, I'm happy to do that. But we were definitely kind of relieved. If you're a box owner or part of the staff that runs the open, you understand there's a degree of stress that comes along with hosting the open. I'm just trying to make sure that's a really good experience for the athletes, especially for the first-time athletes, the multi-year athletes. Everybody's coming in with their own baggage or their own expectations, and so we have to work really, really hard to try and meet all of them. And I think everybody had a good time. We ended up having three teams, and so our team float around and find out. I don't really know how we're going to find out in the standings. I don't really care. I'm just proud for all the athletes, not only in our team, but the rest of the athletes participating in this open, because I think we like doubled the amount of athletes that signed up for the open this year. And so proud for support that metric. And now the 2024 season of training starts. And so we just had a really good workout. I have another 7-ish crew that I meet up with every Saturday here at Hampton Roads. And so if you're around, you want to drop into the box, it is one of the best places you can train. So a lot of good athletes, a lot of good just kind of attitudes coming along. We did overhead, what did we do today? Overhead walking lunges and box jumps and slam balls, and so it was good. And then we did some accessory work after that. Excuse me, I'm gonna talk about that cough in a minute. We did some sled pulls and some kettlebell deadlifts and strict pull-ups, and so just an overall good 1 hour of workout. I was imagining as if this was the training montage for Creed. So I'm gonna go see, the wifey and I have a date this afternoon. We're gonna see Creed 3. She hasn't seen Creed 1 or 2. Don't ask why, she just hasn't seen them. So we watched Creed 1 the other night, Creed 2 last night. We're caught up now. It's about to go down. And so we're in the back of Hampton Roads, and I'm like, this is the training montage of the movie. I don't care if the rest of the movie is crap. It's not going to be crap because it's going to be really good. But like when it comes to training montages of any kind of fighting movie or Rocky or boxing movie, it's on. I love that portion. And so I'm really, really excited to see that movie. But so a lot of good stuff. You know, like I said, the culmination of the 2023 open season. And now it becomes just what other things can we do to make the best CrossFit experience we can offer here in Hampton Roads. And I'm very, very proud to be part of the staff. And so I'm looking forward to the rest of the things we can bring to our community and just get everybody to level up just a little bit more. So I said last week I was at Colorado Springs for Rocky Mountain Cyber Symposium, and so that was like last week technically. No, last week. And it is what it is. It's a major AFSEA event, and so we had a lot of the keynote speeches. I had my shadow agenda where I was doing some expeditionary communications things, and then also talking to some enterprise IT teammates as well as vendors from industry. And so it was cool. I've never been to Colorado Springs. I haven't been there in a hot minute. Maybe like I went to a base visit when I was in ROTC back in the year of our Lord, whatever it is, 1900 something. And but it was cool. We got to see the mountains. We got a little bit of snow. I did get back really, really late Thursday evening. And then I think it was just a combination, like anything else. When you travel, you're in close proximity and then you're not necessarily eating the healthiest. But I think some of that stuff just kind of left like a weird bug with me, because I've been sick for the last couple days. Before that though, I had a really good time. And so a lot of the engagements that I had was very, very fruitful. I even had like a mini reunion with some of my PACAF teammates. So shout out to Alex, Pops, and Rachel. We had a good dinner in our hotel, just kind of reminiscing. We sort of talked about Pops hosting like his own lair thing that we have, and we may or may not have matching Colorado cardigans, and then we may or may not only play music that comes from CDs or tapes. There was a lot of conversations that happened, because that's just kind of the conversation we have when we get together. But it was a really good time reuniting with some old teammates. But yeah, there is a like any of those major AFSEA events, it can be draining at times as far as just kind of back-to-back meeting with people, trying to meet up with people. Some difficult conversations, not really difficult, but like they needed to happen, and they best happen in person versus over email. And then me kind of setting up for, like always, just setting up for the next thing, setting up for the next Battle of the Events key decision briefs that are happening in March, and then maybe even trickling into April when we go into Robbins. I'll be heading to Georgia for XCOM Roundup. And so there's just a lot of stuff going on. Not kidding, that actually was some of the calculus as far as I need to take a break. I just know that I'm starting to get non-in-harmony as far as my work-life situation. And so I wanted to make sure that, hey, I need to take some time to rebalance. But what I wanted to talk about this week was a kind of like three things that I heard at Rocky Mountain. Just kind of rapid fire. Like I said, this one is a catch-up, kind of like a bridge episode, because I'm really going to focus on next week's episode. I want to end season 6 with a bang, and I have a really good topic I want to talk about. But this week, a little bit rapid fire, just kind of random thoughts off the cuff. So first one that I want to talk about was I heard the term General Skinner and General Blackwell talked about the term talent leadership. So you may have heard talent management a lot. That's a very common, maybe it's an industry word, but I know talent management itself is pretty, that phrase is very common in the Air Force. But now I think it's a degree of talking about talent leadership. And what we're talking about is just the human element of the Air Force. Obviously in my functional community, technology is going to be a large part of what we deal with. But inevitably the technology doesn't really matter unless the humans that support it and are part of the warfighting force aren't prepared to actually leverage and use said technology. And so to make sure that we're deliberate, there's some interesting changes afoot. I don't know exactly when and where these ideas are going to get solidified or decisions are going to be made, but we're talking about maybe holistically changing some of the architecture of our actual workforce. And so what does that mean for communicators? Maybe that means, you know, you have kind of like the, if I call it a trifecta, you have your deployable expeditionary communications, your in garrison IT communicators, and then also your cyber operators. And so potentially when anybody off the street looks at a 1 Delta or a 17 Delta, I'm like, yeah, you do all three of those, right? Like, no, not really. I'm probably going to be really good at one of them, or I have most experience in one of them. But then I've had tangential, maybe that's the word, experience with some of the other ones, but like not enough to the point where I'm an expert in that field. And so instead of having a breadth of experience, maybe we're going to restructure our force to have depth of experience, and then we have to actually back it up with that's what we value in the Air Force. In other words, how do we promote from within? How do we engage those both military, enlisted, and civilian workforce to be like, hey, this is a good, worthwhile thing that you want to be in within the Air Force, and you can have some good career satisfaction. You should have that internal drive to want to serve your country, obviously, because we can't monetarily compete with industry, but there should be some things as the reason why we create that environment and culture as to why you want to continue to serve. And so that's easier said than done, but like that idea of focusing on talent leadership, as in the human element of what we do as a community, I think is very, very exciting. And so, and I'm excited to be part of some of those conversations, how we can kind of shape the future. I may or may not see that future by the time I hang up my uniform, but that idea of helping, and at minimum, maybe not necessarily it's our idea via the senior leaders, but like hearing exactly what you all have across the Air Force. If you get asked the question to participate, participate. This is your opportunity to try and set the stage for the foundations for the future of our Air Force and our community. So make sure you don't mess up that opportunity, because we need everybody's all hands on deck to make sure we get the best model to move forward with. Item number two was this is kind of going back to, there's an art and science of what I do at my level within the cyber community, and it's trying to articulate to not only senior leadership, like in the Pentagon per se, that has to understand resourcing and that nature, but also I'm in the Air Force. So in other words, the Air Force is led by pilots predominantly. I want to make sure that they understand exactly what we bring to the fight. And so a lot of times the art and science I talk about is trying not to overburden or impress non-communicators with our technical jargon, because nobody cares or doesn't care about all those theses. They trust that whatever we're talking about is going to be taking care of the details. But the art and science of articulating exactly what cyberspace operations brings to the fight and how we need to uniquely employ it and deploy it, I think is very, very important. And so the idea, I heard this phrase, required operational conditions. First of all, I like it because the acronym is ROC, obviously. And so that's the reason why I like it. But that idea, it's a different version of desired end state, that phrase we learn in JP5 as far as our military planning. But required operational conditions, I think that's a different mindset that we can start thinking about, is like, yeah, so we don't need to have everything. We need to have the everything under the sun in order to do our job. We need these minimum conditions in order to make sure we can do our job. And anything on top of that, we can prioritize if it comes push to shove. We want to have those pieces, but being very distinct of what we mean and saying these are the things that we need our operators, the tools and capabilities they need in order to do their job. And so I have to figure out this is going to be continuous along for the remainder of my tour here, both on the enterprise IT and the warfighting comm side of the house. How do I cleanly articulate the required operational conditions that not only the six in our community shapes, but also across between the two in the ISR community and the three. I think we're trying to find methods that we can actually converge our complementary efforts into one versus stovepipe efforts. Again, easier said than done, but that's just kind of the place where I'm at right now. And I have part of my job is to try and find those convergence roads to make sure that we are truly building the required operational conditions as a force, not just for my local community, if that makes sense. Finally, the other topic that I want to talk about is I was fortunate enough to go to my boss's promotion ceremony. So it was really, really beautiful. Had the backdrop of the Colorado mountains and the families were there, and it was really, really cool. I love going to promotion ceremonies. First time I went to a general officer promotion ceremony where the unfurling of the flag and a couple more things in there, the ruffles and flourishes. But nonetheless, it's still an accomplishment. So congratulations to my boss, Heather Blackwell, for officially pinning on her one star. But one portion of her speech that kind of resonated with me was while she's proud to wear her star, what she said was, it's not what you get with the star, but what you give. I was like, oh, okay. I wrote that down. Like I was in the middle of the thing. I'm like, ooh, I went to my phone and kind of typed it out. Because I think that actually is a good resonance of a strong leader, right? And she understands the what it took probably to achieve that level of accomplishment for her, but she's not trying to let it ride on that rank. There's a responsibility with that rank. Just like I'm still trying to learn what I'm supposed to be doing as a colonel, and I'm still going through these seasons and waves as far as my first year as a colonel, understanding my place in the world, what I'm supposed to be doing, how do I interface with my peers? That's actually a very interesting piece. And then just what am I supposed to be doing? How everybody needs me, I should say, to perform in my certain role because I am a senior leader and I need to not screw it up. And so one of the biggest fears I have is letting people down, because I need to know how to execute my job correctly and most efficiently. And so I want to make sure I'm giving everything that everybody expects of me, right? So I don't, the rank has its privileges, pieces as being a colonel. I'm like, I guess those are cool. Sure, there's parking spots and you kind of get to sit at the front of the table and people kind of speak to you differently, but they shouldn't. They should hopefully speak to you within your position and just understand that there's work needs to be done. My level of responsibilities, her level of responsibilities, they're just different from other people, but they're still integrated with a larger team, and we have to make sure that we execute our job for each other. So those are going to be some, she often, with the tier of other leaders that I look up to, drop some knowledge nuggets, and I'm always trying to figure out how I can leverage and kind of live up to those words, because they really do reflect ideas that I agree with. So I want to make sure I'm leading from the front and being a good leader by example. So But yeah, those are some of the, like I said, this week was a little bit of a bridge of ideas, kind of catching you up as far as going on in the open, and then what things that happened at Rocky Mountain Cyber Symposium. And so a lot of cool other things happening in the background. I'll save them for season seven when I come back. It'll just be an undefined break, and then I'll be able to, I'll find the right motivation when I want to come back, but I'll save those thoughts for next week. And so, like I said, but you haven't already, check out contentelevation.co to follow most of my, all of my content. And if you want to back brief on some of the older things that I've produced, you can also find me on this YouTube channel if that's the method that you like to choose to listen to podcasts. But yeah, team, it's been really, really good already, and I've still got a lot of fight in me. I just know that I'm going to need a break a little bit, but I got one more episode in me, so I'm looking forward to next week and sharing that my thoughts with you. So until then, go see Creed 3. I'm going to go see Creed 3 today with the wifey, and I'm looking forward to that, and we'll talk to you next week. Peace.